Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel Lambi Race Ke Ghode, and in this session we are going to learn about the chapter 5 and the heading is What Books and Burials Tell Us. So we are going to concentrate in this chapter about the books, what they actually mean, and the burials. There are several types of burials we will come to know in this chapter. So make sure that if I have not watched and subscribed my channel and not watched the previous chapters like 1, 2, 3 and 4 of NCERT class 6 hour past 1. This is basically NCERT class 6 hour past 1 history we are going to discuss in this chapter, and make sure that you also subscribe to my channel. So let's move further. Here the question, as you know, every chapter started with some kind of imagination or question. So see the girl, her name is Mary. So as the bell rang, the teacher asked the student to follow him because they were going to library for the first time. When Mary stepped inside, she found that library was much larger. So Mary went to a library, and when she stepped inside, she found that the library was much larger than their classroom, and there were so many shelves, and all were full of books. Then in one corner was a cupboard filled with large old volume. Seeing her trying to open the cupboard, the teacher said that cupboard has very special books on different religions. So that cupboard was full of books of different religions. Did you know that we have a set of Vedas? Let me tell you, there are four Vedas we will come to know. Then what are Vedas? Mary wondered. Let us find out. So we will find out about Vedas in this basically a starting question. So let's move further. One of the oldest book in the world. So Vedas are one of the oldest books of in the world. So you have heard about the Vedas. There are four of them: Rig Veda, Sam Veda, Yajur Veda and Athar Veda. The oldest Veda is Rig Veda, composed about 3500 years ago. So see, very old, 3500 years ago. And from where? From 2000. So let me tell you that 2000 is the year we have taken as benchmark. So from 2000 years, 3500 years ago from 2000. So the Rig Veda include more than 1000 hymns. There are basically hymns, 1028 hymns are there. 1028 is the exact number, do remember this also. So called Sukta, these are called Sukta or well said. So Sukta means well said. Okay, so these hymns are in praise of various gods and goddess. So there are three gods are especially important: Agni, the god of fire, Indra, a warrior, and Soma, a plant. So there are three basically god very famous, and you will often find that Agni is mentioned everywhere. So Agni is one of the most important god among the three also. So these hymns were composed by sages are called rishis. Priests taught the students to recite and memorize each syllable, word and sentence bit by bit with great care. So priests, those who are teaching the Vedas, emphasis on students to, you know, memorize all syllable, word and sentence. Most of the hymns were composed, taught and learnt by men. So see, most of them are composed and taught and learnt by men. So women are basically discarded here. See, the women empowerment we are talking about, and this is how you come to know that this problem was through the Vedas only. It started many years ago. So this is a very societal problem coming through ancients. A few were composed by women. So some very few were composed by women. The Rig Veda is in old or Vedic Sanskrit, so the language is Sanskrit, which is different from Sanskrit you learn in school these days. So there is a difference which you presently you learn Sanskrit and the Sanskrit which were actually used in Rig Veda are very different. So let's move on the next page. So Sanskrit and other language we are going to talk about. Sanskrit is part of family of languages known as Indo-European. So whenever question comes that Sanskrit belongs to which family, you have to answer Indo-European. Indo-European, remember. Some Indian languages such as Assamese, Gujarati, Hindi, Kashmiri and Sindhi, and many European languages. See, here the European languages are also generated from Sanskrit only, such as English, French, German, Greek, Italian, Spanish, etc. Belong to this family. They are called a family because they originally had words in common. So there are many words which are common in these languages. So that is why they belong to the same family, Sanskrit. Take for the example Matra. In Matra, Sanskrit means mother. And in Ma also in Hindi, same meaning, mother. So everything is correlated. These are very interrelated. So Matra in Sanskrit, Ma in Hindi and mother in English. So there is a question now. Do you notice any similarities? Yes, you have noticed. Other languages used in subcontinent belong to different families. So there are different families also apart from Sanskrit. For instance, those used in Northeast belong to Tibeto-Burman family. Why? Because the place is so close to Tibetan and Burman region, so they basically belong to this family. So Tamil, Telugu, Kannada and Malayalam belong to Dravidian family, remember this also. And languages spoken in Jharkhand and parts of Central India belong to Austroasiatic family. So basically how many families you found in this basically short explanation: Austroasiatic, Dravidian, Tibeto-Burman family, then Sanskrit itself. Okay, let's move further. The books we use are written and printed. So the books we use are written and printed. The Rig Veda was recited and heard rather than read. So the Rig Veda was basically not initially written. It was basically remembered by many pupils. And it was heard and rather than read. So it was written down several centuries after it was first composed and printed less than 200 years ago. So it is printed less than 200 years ago, remember this also. Then how historians study Rig Veda? Historians like archaeologists find out about the past, but in addition to material remains, they examine written sources as well. So let us see how they study the Rig Veda. Some of the hymns, there are total 1028 hymns, remember this. Then in Rig Veda are in form of dialogues, basically it is in the form of dialogue. This is part of one such hymn, a dialogue between a sage named Vishwamitra and two rivers, Bias and Satluj. So we are going to learn about one of the hymn which is basically in the form of dialogue. So let's see, let's move on the next page. See, this is the page, we cannot read this because this is so different. A page from manuscript of Rig Veda. The manuscript of Rig Veda on birch bark was found in Kashmir about 150-100 years ago. It was used to prepare one of the earliest printed texts in Rig Veda as well as English translation. It is now preserved in library in Pune, Maharashtra. Fine. So this is the basically a discussion. Vishwamitra now saying, O river, come down from mountain like two swift horses. So basically Vishwamitra is talking to river, talking to rivers, basically Bias and Ravi. Okay, he is talking to these two rivers. And like two shining cows that licks their calves. So very, you know, fascinating kind of talking is going there. So you move like chariots to sea. Through powers of Indra, you are full of water and wish to unite with one another. Now the rivers replied, we who are full of water move along the path that the gods have made for us. Once we start flowing, we cannot be stopped. Why do you pray to us, O Seg? Now with river also asked some question to Seg. Now Vishwamitra replied, O sisters, please listen to me. The singer who has come from distance with his chariots and carts, let your waters not rise above our axles so that we can cross safely. So basically there is a purpose. Okay, the rivers again replied, we will listen to your prayers so that you can cross safely. Historians point out, so here the conversation ends. Historians point out that this hymn was composed in area where these rivers flow. So basically they flow in present day Punjab. They also suggest that the Seg lived in society where horses and cows were valued animals. So how historians use these sources, you come to know now. They basically find out inferences. That is why the rivers are compared to horses and cows. Do you think chariots were also important? Give reason for your answer. Read the verses and find out what are the modes of transport that are mentioned. Now this is your job. Do this. Other rivers, especially the Indus and its tributary. Tributary are the smaller rivers which contributes into the merge into the large or the main river, and the Saraswati are also named in hymns. The Ganga and Yamuna are named only once. So see, the those days very famous rivers were Ravi and Vyas, okay, then Saraswati, then there is a mention of Indus also. However, the Ganga and Yamuna are named only once, so they were not very famous rivers those days. This is also a good question, sometimes comes in exam, so do remember. And let's move to the next page. So cattle, horses and chariots we are going to read. So there are many prayers in Rig Veda for cattle. So those days were very famous for cattle, because many people, for them cattle is all their wealth. They do not, you know, ran behind the land purchase and etc. Those days many wars were incited due to cattle conflict. So do remember this. Cattle were very important during Rig Veda period. So children, especially sons and horses. So horses were yoked to chariots that were used in battles, which were fought to capture cattle. See here, battles were also fought for land. So there is battles also fought for land, which was important for pasture. So again it is related to some kind of cattle issue only. So pasture is required for cattle to feed upon and for growing hardy crops that ripened quickly, such as barley. Some battles were fought for water and to capture people. Some of the wealth that was obtained was kept by leaders, so it is not distributed. Some was given to priest and the rest was distributed among the people. So not all the amount was distributed to people, however some amount is distributed. Some wealth was used for the performance of yajanas. Yajanas means yagya, okay, or sacrifices in which offerings were made into the fire. So very famous actually, this period was dominated by many yajanas, okay, and sacrifices. These were meant for god and goddesses. These were done to make god and goddesses happy. Offerings could include ghee, grain, and in some cases animals also. So we also do present day also Hindu society do this. Okay, so most men took part in these wars. So most men do take part in these wars. There was no regular army, but there were assemblies where people met and discussed matters of wars and peace. So there were assemblies those days also. Okay, they also choose leaders who were often brave and skilled warriors. So they also choose their leaders also. Words to describe people. There are several ways of describing people in terms of the work they do, the language they speak, and the place they belong to, their family, their communities, and culture practices. So let us see some of the words used to describe people found in Rig Veda. So basically they were described on the basis of the cultural practice or the family they belong to, etc., or the language they used or the work they done. So these are the basis upon which they were described. Let us find out. There are two groups who are described in terms of their work. The priests, sometimes called Brahmins, who performed various rituals, and Rajas. So these were upper class, Brahmins and Rajas were basically Kshatriya, most of them. So these Rajas were not like once you will be learning about later. They did not have capitals, cities, palaces or armies, nor did they collect tax. So they were very different from those who came later upon. And those who came later upon, they maintained army, they had palaces, they basically made their capitals also. So those who were remained Rajas during Rig Veda period were not having these kind of features. Remember this. Now let's move to the next page. Generally, sons did not automatically succeed father as Raja. There was no hereditary system. Read the previous section once more and see whether you can find out what the Rajas did. So basically they did Yajnas. Anyway, you have to find out. So two words were used to describe the people or community as whole. Okay. One was word Jana. Jana means as a whole, the peoples, which we still use in Hindi, Jan, and other languages also. The other was Vis. So we do not use Vis present day. The word Vaisya comes from Vis. You will learn more about this in chapter 8. So wait till chapter 8. Several Vis or Janas are mentioned by name. So we find reference to Purujana or Vis, the Bharatjana or Vis, or the Yadujana or Vis. Now one more question. Do any of these names sound familiar? Sometimes the people who compose the hymns describe themselves as Aryas. So those who composed the hymns, okay, they describe themselves as Arya. Call their opponents Dasas. So see, there is a different strata also, different society also they made upon the work they did. So these were people who did not perform sacrifices, like Dasas. Dasas were not did not perform sacrifices and probably spoke different languages. Apart from Sanskrit, they used different languages. Later the term Dasa and the feminine Dasi came to mean slaves. So there were slaves in Rig Veda also. So it is basically the problem which had genesis in very past. Slaves were women and men who were often captured in war. Okay, so remember we have already discussed that some fights, some wars were also done for capturing the people. So those who were captured were slaves. They were women and men both. They were treated as property. So there was not humanity, human kind of thing. So for them, they were treated as property of their owners, who could make them do whatever work they wanted. so they had no rights. Okay, so while the Rig Veda was being composed in northwest of subcontinent, there were other developments elsewhere. Let us look at the some of these. We'll see. Salient Silent Sentinels, the story of megaliths. Look at the illustration on the next page. Okay, so let's see. These are some illustration. You can notice this. I'm giving you 5 seconds to see this picture. Okay, fine. So these stone boulders are known as megaliths, literally big stones. So those stones which were actually around the burial, like this was the shape, these are called megaliths. Megaliths means big stones. These were carefully arranged by people, okay, and were used to mark burial sites. The practice of erecting megaliths began about 3000 years ago. So 3000 years from which year? From 2000. Okay, so and was prevalent throughout the Deccan, South India, in Northeast and Kashmir. So it was prevalent in Deccan, South India, Northeast also, and Kashmir also. So let's move further on the next page. So some important, see the picture again. This is the megalith. Big stones are called megaliths, and this is the burial. There is a way also, there is a hole you can see here. So some important megalith sites are shown on map 2, page 14. Then while some megaliths can be seen on surface, other megaliths burials are often underground. So they were also underground. Sometimes archaeologists find a circle of stone boulders or a large stone standing on the ground. These are the only indications that there are burials beneath. So basically stones, big stones were used to mark the place which is called burials. There were several things that people did to make megaliths. We have made a list here. Try and arrange them in correct order. So digging pit in earth, transporting a stone, breaking boulders, placing a stone in position, finding suitable stone, shaping stones, burials, and dead. So you have to answer the correct sequence of this in comment section, so that I come to know that you are actually understanding the thing, and I will appreciate if you answer the right thing. Okay, then this type of megaliths is known as a schist. This is basically called schist. Some schist, like one shown here, have portholes which could be used as entrance. So this is basically a porthole which is used as entrance. Fine, let's move further. Now all these burials have some common feature. Generally the dead were buried with distinctive pots. So you can see some pots here. So it is not here, okay, fine. So the dead were buried with distinguishing pots, which are called black and red ware. So whenever word come black and red ware, this is many times asked in UPSC or other civil service examination. You have to answer that these pots are belongs to megalith period, or you can say this belongs to burial kind of thing, and this also belong to Vedic period. This do not belong to, you know, Harappan period or Civil Valley, Indus Valley civilization. So also found are tools and weapons of iron. So some tools are here. These are the tools, and this is basically a weapon, a dagger. So here is the explanation. Iron equipment found from megalith burials. Left top is horse equipment, left below is axis, these are axis, and below one is dagger, this is dagger. Fine, let's move on to the next page. So finding out about social difference, this is also very important. Now we are going to study about the social differences. Archaeologists think that objects found with a skeleton probably belong to dead person. Okay, sometimes more objects are found in one grave than in another. Find Brahmagiri on map 2, page 14, that you have to do. Here one skeleton was buried with 33 gold beads, 2 stone beads and 4 copper bangles, see, very diversified, and 1 conch shell. Other skeletons have only a few pots. So these finds suggest that there was some differences in the status among the people who were buried because of the different kinds of materials, different kind of equipments, things being buried with the person. You can find out that there might have been some societal or the status difference in that society. Some were rich and other poor, some chiefs, other followers. Fine. Were some burial spots meant for certain families? We are going to be answered this question. Sometimes megaliths certain more than one skeleton. These indicate that people perhaps belonging to some family were buried in some place, though not at same time. So one burial was used for many times. Okay, the bodies of these who died later were brought into the grave through portholes. Remember that porthole we have discussed. A stone circle or boulder placed on surface probably served as signpost to find the burial site so that people could return to same place whenever they wanted. Okay, very good. Then a special burial at Inam Gaon. Again, you have to find this on map 2. You have to see the map 2. It is a site on the river Ghod, a tributary of Bhima. It was occupied between 3600 and 2700 years ago. Here, adults were generally buried in ground, laid out straight with head towards north. So, they see Inam Gaon may come in question that in Inam Gaon burial, the head of the dead was in which direction? So, you have to answer north. Sometimes burial were within the houses. Vessels that probably contain food and water were placed with dead. Very good. One man was found buried in large four-legged clay jar in a courtyard of five-roomed houses. House, one of the largest house at the site. So one man was also found that he was buried in his house only that had five rooms. Okay, let's move further on the next page. So in the center of the settlement, this house also had a granary. Okay, the body was placed in cross-legged position. So it was placed in cross-legged position. Do you think this was the body of chief? Give reason for your answer. Maybe you have, this is your imagination, you have to answer. What a skeleton studies tell us. So it is easy to make out a skeleton of child from its small size. However, there are no major differences in the bones of girl and boys. Okay, can we make out whether a skeleton was that of man or woman? Very difficult, but it can be. Sometimes people decide on the basis of what is found with the skeleton. Very good. This if something called jewelry is found, it might be of woman. However, there are problems with this. Often men also wore ornaments, so this is a problematic kind of inference. So a better way of figuring out the sex of a skeleton is to look at the bone structure. So see, the bone structure will tell everything. The hip or pelvis area of women is generally larger. Okay, this is the general biology to enable childbearing. Okay, these distinctions are based on modern skeleton studies. About 2000 years ago, there was a famous physician named Charak. Okay, हु रोट ए बुक ऑन मेडिसिन नोन एज चरक संहिता. सो हु रोट द चरक संहिता, देन यू हैव टू आंसर चरक, एंड इट वॉज रोट 2000 ईयर्स अगो. देयर ही स्टेट्स दैट ह्यूमन बॉडी हैड 360 बोन्स. दिस इज मच लार्जर नंबर दैन 200 बोन्स दैट आर रिकोगनाइज इन मॉडर्न एनाटोमी. चरक अराइव्ड एट दिस फिगर बाई काउंटिंग टीथ, ज्वाइंट्स एंड कार्टिलेज ऑल्सो. सो दैट इज वाई नंबर इंक्रीज्ड. हाउ डू यू थिंक ही फाउंड आउट अबाउट द ह्यूमन बॉडी इन सच ग्रेट डिटेल? यू हैव टू थिंक एंड आंसर इन द कमेंट सेक्शन. दिस इज वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन, यू हैव टू आंसर एंड आई हैव द आंसर. फाइन, लेट्स मूव फर्दर. ऑक्यूपेशन एट इनाम गांव, वट वर द ऑक्यूपेशंस? सो आर्कियोलॉजिस्ट हैव फाउंड सीड्स ऑफ वीट ओवर देयर, बार्ले, राइस, पल्सेस, मिलेट्स, पीज, सीसम, वेरी टू मच वेराइटी, बोन्स ऑफ नंबर ऑफ एनिमल्स, मेनी वेयरिंग कट मार्क्स दैट शोज दैट दे माइट हैव बीन यूज एज फूड. सो दिस इज वन ऑफ द इन्फ्रेंस दे हैव टेकन आउट दैट दे द बोन्स आर कट. So it might have been used as food because animal, if you have to eat, it has to be cut down. Have also been found. These include cattle, buffalo, goat, sheep, dog, horse, ass, pig, and sambar, spotted deer, black buck, antelope, hare, mongoose, besides bird, crocodile, turtle, crab food. Crab, fish, etc. There is evidence that fruits such as bear, amla, jamun, dates, and variety of berries were collected. So do remember. Let's move on to the next page. So with this, we are at the end of the chapter. Use this evidence to list the possible occupation of people at Inam Gaon. You have to do this. Elsewhere, what happened? Now find China in your atlas. You have to find China on your atlas. Around 3500 years ago, we find some of the first evidence of writing in China. See, this is the basically picture which has some writing. So these writings were on animal bones. These are called oracle bones because they were used to predict the future. So very, you know, futuristic kind of thing. Kings got a scribe to write question on the bones. Would they win battle? So this is the question which is written on the bone of a cattle. Then would the harvest be good? This is also one of the question. So would they have sons? This is also a question. The bones were then put into the fire. See how they come to know. And they cracked, because of the heat. Then fortune tellers studied these cracks and tried to predict the future. So as you may expect, they sometimes made mistakes also. These kings lived in palaces in cities. They amassed vast quantities of wealth also, including large elaborately decorated bronze vessels. However, they did not know use of iron. So still the Chinese people were not aware of the use of iron. So here is one more question. List one different difference between Raja of Rigveda and these kings. So you have to do this. Fine, we have completed this chapter. Let's see the keywords. Vedas we have read, languages we have come to know, hymns we have already discussed, chariot we have discussed, which is used in battles, sacrifices done by Rajas of Rigveda period. Then Raja, we came to know that they are different from the later on Rajas. Slaves, we have come to know that there were many wars and the people captured were called as slaves. They were men and women both. Megaliths, we have come to know that big stones. Okay, then burials we come to know, and a skeleton we have studied. And we have also studied that women and men has different anatomy, skeleton anatomy. So with this, we are completing this chapter. Bye bye till then, and I will be again coming with the new chapter 6. Then please subscribe to the channel. Bye bye.